But I'm so glad to see you all in worship today, and also those who are watching from YouTube. Good morning, God bless you, and let's prepare our hearts now for our worship this Sunday morning. I invite everyone in this place to stand. Let us begin our worship service this morning. Let us confidently approach the Father's throne of grace, knowing that the way there has been opened through the perfect sacrifice of God the Son in Jesus Christ. And this gospel truth, this gospel joy, has been poured out into our hearts by God the Holy Spirit. So as you come to worship this morning, may the favor, the blessings, the joy, and the peace of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. You may be seated, church.
The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Church, let us ready our hearts today, on this very morning, to come into God's presence today and be reminded of His amazing love. Let's ready our hearts and worship Him on this morning. Love on the line. Sing it, church. With arms held high, Lord, I give my life, knowing I'm found in Christ, in your love forever. With all I am, in your grace I stand, the greatest of all. His mercy and His furious love. Let's sing it together. Mercy roars like hurricane winds. Furious love lay waste to my church, and we praise Him again. With arms held high, Lord, I give my life, knowing I'm found in Christ, in your love forever. With all I am, in your grace I stand, the greatest of all. love of God, my Savior. Let's bow our heads, church. Now, let's take a moment of silence in the presence of our Lord. Personally, let's take the time to rethink back on our actions and our thoughts that we've done. And let us confess our sins. The Holy Spirit speak to every single one of us and reveal in our hearts. Let us confess together, church, all our sins. All the bad things we've done or thought of. And all the good things we failed or forgotten to do. I'll give us all a moment of confession. Rescued my soul, to the one who has welcomed me home, to the one who is Savior of all, I sing forever. One more time, let's sing it, church. To the one who has rescued my soul, to the one who has welcomed me home, to the one who is Savior of all, I sing. Everyone who has confessed today, let's be reminded that our God is merciful and we give our lives to Him with arms held high. With arms held high, Lord, I give my life, knowing I'm found in Christ, in your love forever. With arms bow our heads in prayer, church. Your word says, Lord, but God being rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. And by grace, you have been saved. And thank you, God, for your words of grace. And Father, we also want to thank you for all your amazing love you put on the line, all your blessings, all your grace to each and every one of us. You're a kind and loving God, and you love each and every one of us. And you're also a merciful Lord to every weakness that we have in sin and in our wrongdoings. And Father, on this morning, we want to lift up all praise to you, but we also want to lay down all of our sins, all of our wrongdoings in your presence. Only you know everything in our hearts, Lord. And we want to pray for each heart that has come to you to confess today. And we pray that you're merciful and you're forgiving to each and every one of us. May each and every one of us be able to grow more and more like you each day and fight off our sinful nature. And Father, we also want to pray for the service this morning from the beginning to the end, Lord, that every praise, every worship, every prayer can be according to your will and only worship you. We pray every seed of your gospel be able to be planted in the hearts of your church, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. In the name of Lord Jesus Christ, we pray and give thanks. Everybody say, amen. Now, church, let us arise and let us declare our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Why don't we say hi to our neighbor? It's been a long Lebaran holiday. We haven't seen each other in so long. Hello, hello. Hello to those online too. Hallelujah. Church, our God is an amazing God. He loves us so, and his grace is abundant every day. So let's, together on this morning, let's praise and sing all of his mercies. With joy, let's clap our hands and praise God.
I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing, I will sing, I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. Hallelujah.
One more time. may be seated, church. Now, church, let's prepare our hearts and minds to hear the word of God. And let each of every one of us be reminded that even though that we're already free from the chains of sin, let's always have this want and this thirst to be near to the heart of God. And let's be reminded that as God has loved us first, let us love each other as the church of God. Let's prepare our hearts and let's worship Him. There is a place of quiet rest near to the heart of God. Comfort sweetness with our God.
Amen. Can I pray for the Sunday school children, the teachers and the parents or the caretakers who will accompany them? Hey, Satria. Hey, Jason. All right. Let's pray. Hello. Lord Jesus, bless His children as they go to Sunday school this morning so that they can enjoy Your word, enjoy their teachers, and be able to learn about Your love, Your grace, Your power. Bless the teachers, bless their parents as well, who will accompany them so that they can have a good time enjoying Your presence and Your word. Thank You, Lord Jesus. In Your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, off you go. Thank you, guys. Today, our preacher is not with us, Onsite. Our preacher is from Malang. He's speaking to us online. It's an online sermon. Now, sometimes we do this, and I'd like to explain why here at Darmo we do this, maybe every 3 months, okay? So that, and I see a couple of new faces, so that I can inform you, and you know, it's not something that is like, whoa, too shocking for all of you, maybe some of you, why we do this. Instead of having a live preacher, why do we have online sermon once in a while? Three reasons. Number one, biblical example. We saw, for instance, in the letters of Paul, right? Those letters are being read aloud in front of the church without Paul, the speaker, being there, okay? So we have a biblical example where you hear a sermon, but the speaker is not physically there. Just like all the letters are circulated in all of the churches, but Paul cannot go to all of the churches because, well, he was in prison, right? But still, there's a biblical example of we don't have a live preacher. Second, we have some theological support of why we are doing this. We know that God has blessed us with advanced technology, and I do believe that every good gifts comes from above, right? All the blessings that God has given us, we call them common grace. We have technology, we have internet, we have great cameras, audio, and God can speak to us, whether through a live preacher or through a recording or a live streaming, and I do hope that we can still benefit from that. So we know that we must make use maximize what God has given us, and that's what we do. And finally, so we have biblical example, we have theological support, and finally, why we do this is because of practical consideration. This is more has to do with more of our history here at iREC Darmo, okay? Here in Surabaya, it's been a challenge to find a good English preacher. Rather than trying to force Indonesian preacher to talk in English, and we don't have quite the same communication force. So we have decided, not just me as the pastor here, but also our senior pastor, Pak Yaakob, and the elders have been known, they know about this, that we have decided to maybe once in a while, a few months or so, we will invite good English preacher from, well, anywhere in the world, basically. Because now we are not limited by, you know, city or location, so that you guys can have a diverse preacher as well. Now, please, I like to speak every week, but you might be bored with me. So just in case, I'm just going to try to give different preachers. And this is something that I believe that can edify everyone. So for those three reasons, sometimes we do have an online preacher. And today, we are blessed with one of, with Reverend Irwan Pranoto. He is a professor in Saat Malang, a seminary in Malang, and he will be speaking to us online very soon. And I do hope for those watching here on site that you will really take this seriously in terms of your focus and attention, just as if Reverend Irwan is here. Okay, so we'll help you out, maybe dim the lights, because someone can help me with that, I mean, just the front, yeah? So that we can focus on him, and as if he's here, give him your focus, and I do hope that the Word of God will speak to us all. So, let's welcome Reverend Irwan to speak to us this morning.
Shalom. Good morning, church. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I'm very happy that I can greet you all today in this iREC Darmo second worship service. Although I am not able to meet you all physically, but the Lord has given us a great opportunity through this media and devices so that we still can come together as church to worship our Lord. Praise be to God. Today, we will together learn about the theme related to Christian freedom entitled Free Yet Demanded to Love, a reflection on 1 Corinthians 8, verse 9 to 13. Before we start reading and meditating the word of our Lord, let us bow our head and pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord, grateful for this wonderful opportunity. We worship you, and at this time we will together learn from your word. Please bless this time in front of us, Lord, as well as all the devices used in broadcasting the preaching of your word, so that God's word may be delivered clearly and all your people may receive blessings. May God the Holy Spirit prepare our heart, and please help your weak and limited servant to be an instrument of your glory that brings blessings to your people. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Okay, now let's open our Bible and read together with me from 1 Corinthians 8, verse 9 to 13. I will read this passage from English Standard Version. Here is the word of the Lord. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9 to 13. But take care that this right of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if anyone sees you who have knowledge eating in an idol's temple, will he not be encouraged, if his conscience is weak, to eat food offered to idols? And so by your knowledge, this weak person is destroyed, the brother for whom Christ died. Verse 12. Thus, sinning against your brothers and wounding their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food makes my brother stumble, I will never eat meat, lest I make my brother stumble. Here is the word of God. Brothers and sisters in Christ, I was told that you all have been exploring the topic of freedom in Christ for the past few months. What does freedom actually mean? There are some people who say that freedom is actually no restriction, unrestrained, no limit. But in the end, they become wild. Everyone does not want to be regulated. They act as they please and violate various matters, including the freedom of others. So that one person's freedom eventually becomes a violation to the freedom of other people. Or there are some others who say that freedom means should not be forced, must be free to choose just anything or express anything, but eventually became very liberal, rejected rules and orders, including any religious practices and doctrines, and demanded that people accept everything as permissible and right. So at the end, don't want to be forced, but instead force others to accept what they want. You see? Men in their sinful nature can never gain or exercise the freedom as they formulated it. That's why we need to return to God's word. What does freedom really mean? What is the true freedom? And of course, we, as the people who have been redeemed by Christ, understand it as freedom in Christ. Today, we will learn from the passage that we just read together, 1 Corinthians 8, verse 9 to 13. And before going any further, let's start by understanding the context first. What is the Apostle Paul talking about here? What was the situation that took place? What happened back then? Scholars believe that in this first letter to the Corinthian church, Apostle Paul was answering or responding to some of the cases that the Corinthian church was facing. And in chapters 8 to 10, there is a specific case regarding the Corinthian tradition of dealing with food or meat that has been offered to idols, or in technical term, it is often called as eidolotuta, eidolotuta. What the practice or the tradition look like precisely? There are five frequently discussed possibilities about these matters. First, it concerned with eating food sacrificed to idols at the temple of the idols. There were a lot of idols temples in Corinth at the time, and people sacrificed food to idols there. So they had the tradition of eating the food after the food being sacrificed or offered to the idols. Possible number two, it concerned with eating food with unknown history bought in the market. So since meat which has been sacrificed to idols were sellable, so some will sell it in the market, sell the meat in the market. And people, just anyone, could buy it without knowing whether the meat were those which used to be sacrificed to the idols or not. The third possibility is concerned with eating food at parties or gatherings to which Corinthian Christians have been invited, probably in the homes of unbelievers. Here talking about hospitality tradition. Some unbelievers could invite Christians to their homes and offer to them foods which sometimes had been sacrificed to idols. These parties or gatherings could be for any reasons, businesses, for example, or just neighbors, or just any community gatherings, and so on and so forth. The fourth possibility is concerned with eating food related to the Roman imperial cult. In this case, they would need to deal with the government regulation even. So it's not only from their relatives or their friends, but it's concerned with the government regulation. And of course, possible number five is the combination of the above possible situations. It could be any of them, or the mix, the combination of those possibilities. So whatever the situation possible, it is obvious that Paul was advising the Corinthian church about the attitude that they should have as people who has been redeemed by Christ, including on the case of eidolotuta, eating food sacrificed to idols. Can Christian eat food that had been offered to idols? Of course, there seem to be two views or two opinions here. One say it's not allowed at all because it's unclean. It's haram, unclean. However, on the other hand, there are some others say it's okay because Christians don't believe in idols. So there's no need to be worried about. That's okay. There's only one God. They don't believe in idols, so just eat them. That's fine. It is interesting when we look at the arguments that Paul have here to answer this matter in verse 4 to 6. It appears that Paul was using the arguments of some Corinthians fellow who said that it was okay to eat. Here Paul showed his solid Christological thought to answer. Christology is indeed very significant and prominent in many parts of Paul's writings and teachings. in order to see the link between Paul's Christology and his teaching on eidolotuta within this chapter, it is better to start by noting that explicitly the word Christ occurs three times in this chapter. The first occurrence is in verse 6. Verse 6 is very important, very vital to our discussion. Paul puts the phrase Jesus Christ in Jewish foundational monotheistic confession. This Christological monotheistic belief, which confesses that there is only one God in Christ, is being contrasted with the many idols and many gods beliefs. Many scholars have proposed that here in verse 6, Paul is referring to the Shema, which is the Jewish supreme confession of faith. Within a strong Jewish background, the Shema is indeed very essential for Paul. Actually, the Shema itself is the foundational formulation for the story of God and his people. But it has been creatively redefined by Paul with his Christological thought. N.T. Wright, one of the prominent New Testament scholars, said in his book, I quote, Paul has redefined it Christologically, producing what we can only call a sort of Christological monotheism. End of quote. The Shema formulation in Deuteronomy 6 verse 4 is written, I quote, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. End of quote. N.T. Wright argues that Apostle Paul has unprecedentedly expanded the formula by glossing the word God with the Father and Lord with Jesus Christ. Interesting. And adding, in its case, an explanatory phrase. It is what Paul writes. I read verse 6. Yet for us there is one God, the Father, one God, the Father, from whom all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom all things and through whom we exist. We can see that Christological statement in this verse is crystal clear and applied in a supreme monotheistic text. For the Jews, this monotheistic creed is indeed best known. For the Gentiles, which are predominant in Corinthian church, they are still familiar with this statement of faith since it has already in widespread use as the Jewish daily prayer. And it is indeed an essential message for them to know and accept the unique concept of Jewish monotheistic, which has been redefined Christologically. In his teaching on eidolotuta, with various reasons, however, Paul has used this so-called Christological monotheism statement. So it is necessary to take into account Paul's Christology in understanding his teaching on eidolotuta. Brothers and sisters in Christ, there are some dispute concerning whether some parts or whole parts of verse 4 to 6 are quotation from Corinthians or whether some parts are Paul's own formulation. But the whole idea is that Paul seems to agree with the proposition of the Corinthians, or that Paul just confirmed their proposition with the concept of Christological monotheistic belief. It means Paul and the Corinthians have a common agreement that because God in Christ is one, then idol is nothing. So Christians indeed have the freedom to eat or not to eat eidolotuta. However, it neither means that Paul allowed them to eat idolotuta, nor shows Paul's basic argument dealing with idolotuta. Yet until the other parts of this chapter are discussed, which is our passage today, verse 9 to 13, which I believe is very important. So now let's go into our passage. The second and the third occurrences of the word Christ is in verse 11 and 12. The context is concerning the weak brothers for whom Christ has died. The word adelphoi, which means brothers, occurs four times in verses 11 to 13, which shows Paul's concern is actually about affirming the properly conduct of the believers toward their fellow weak brothers. Thus, the Christological idea is about the act of Christ who sacrificed himself and died for the weak brothers, which makes significant and crucial for Christians to do the same and not to sin against what Christ has done. If you see verse 7 and 10, actually there in these two verses bear the picture of the weak brothers. They are those who still accustomed to idols and will be emboldened to eat idolotuta. Well, verse 8 seems to confirm what Paul had been argued in verse 4 to 6. He agrees that idols is just nothing. So not eating will not affect anything bad, and eating also will not affect anything good. And then verse 9 holds the key word in understanding this passage, which is exousia. Anthony Tisleton, another New Testament scholar, translated it as the right to choose. Exousia, the right to choose. Paul argues that though Christians have the right to choose or the freedom to eat or not to eat idolotuta, but they have to deeply consider the effect of their deeds toward their weak brothers to whom Jesus has died for. Anthony Tisleton further notes that for Paul, Christ even has identified himself with the weak brothers by saying that by being a stumbling block to the weak, Christian sins against their weak brothers and they sin against Christ. Christians have to model what their Lord has done, even as they do it just for the Lord himself. Anthony Tisleton notes, and I quote, "Christ died not as an act of self-assertion or claiming rights, but as an act of self-giving love for the sake of the other, not least for," and of course, "the weak." Now, what is the connection between the Christological monotheistic belief that we discussed earlier with the Christological act of sacrificing self in this passage? Again, I want to quote N.T. Wright, who argues that the whole effect is to put into practice the schema itself. There is one God, one Lord, and his people are divine as those who love him and who love their neighbors as themselves. It is to say that Christians does not enough just believe the monotheistic God, but they have to know who that one God is. The Christological monotheistic belief makes them cannot divide God from Christ. The one God is the God in Christ. So they have to act according to what Christ wants them to do or has provides a model for them to act, especially dealing with the weak brothers. So I would like to quote the third New Testament scholar, David E. Garland, who writes in his commentary, I quote, acting on the basis of mere propositional knowledge about God is insufficient. Believers must understand fully the broad sweep of theological implications and let their conduct be leavened with love. End of quote. Otis Sultan also argues, I quote, we miss Paul's point, however, if the claim to truth expressed in the Jewish Christian confession of monotheism is divorced from its existential or self-involving dimension. End of quote. So, brothers and sisters in Christ, Paul's intention in this passage is to teach how Christological belief has to be accompanied with Christological deeds. Christological belief and Christological deeds have to be together. This conclusion is clearly seen just right at the beginning of the passage of the whole chapter, chapter 8, especially if you see verse 1 to 3, indeed stresses on love. Paul argues for the superiority of love compared to knowledge. While knowledge just causes someone to puff up, love leads someone to build up, which most probably means building up the community in Christ. Paul further stresses that the man who loves God not just knows or has knowledge of God, but much more importantly, also known by God. It fits very well with the arguments in the succeeding parts of the chapter. Thus, it can be concluded that the main theme of this chapter is Christian call as the one who knows and believes to the one God in Christ. Christian call to love the weak, just as Christ loved and has died for them. So Christian freedom and Christian love. Brothers and sisters in Christ, as the application for the message that we just meditated together today, is that of course, as Christian, we have the freedom, especially we called it as the freedom in Christ. But never forget that the freedom that we receive from Christ is the freedom that we have to understand it in Christ. So Christology is very important here. You and I, living in this very selfish world, everybody is being selfish. Everybody just think about themselves, their rights, what they want. So it is easy for us to say, I can do anything I want, as long as it did not interfere to my relationship to God. I'm still following God. I'm still serving God. I'm still believing in God. I'm still praying to Him, worshiping Him. So that should be okay. I can do anything. We don't care about what our deeds, our conducts can affect, can impact others. However, Christ did not do as what we just thought. Christ died for us. Christ died for brothers, sisters who were weak. So how can we, people who said that we worship Christ, but we just don't care about what Christ cared for? Because we said that Christ has loved us. Because we said that we have received the love of Christ. It is important for us to know that because we are loved by Christ, because Christ has loved us, so we have to love others. We are demanded to love others. The love that we receive from Christ will demand us to love others, to care about our weak brothers and sisters especially. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, again, we have the freedom. Christ has given us freedom. Christ has given us the freedom that we need. Yet, we are still demanded to love others. So, to conclude our message today, Paul has wonderfully, creatively explained to us, as we believe in one God, and that God is the God in Christ, and Christ is the God who sacrificed himself for us and for those around us. So we have to imitate him, model him, be like him, also care, also love others around us today. May God bless us to grow in Christ and to grow in love. Let us pray together. Father in heaven, we come before you, Lord. We want to thank you for your message. Thank you that you have set us free. Thank you that Christ has died for us. Thank you for your love. And bless us, Lord, and help us, Lord, not just be a person who only enjoy your love, but not being responsible to the love that you have given to us. Help us, strengthen us to love others, to care for our brothers, our sisters, especially those who are weak. Help us to be sensitive that our conducts, our deeds, our words could impact, influence others, become stumbling block for others. Lord, help us. Thank you for your word, and we want to surrender ourselves, Lord, and your church. Bless your word, bless your church, and may we become your witness in this sinful world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you, church.
Now, church, to respond to the word of God, let us give the offering. The offering can be done two ways, as usual, through the church bank account or the QR code, or be given physically at the pockets in the back. And while the offering is being held, let us sing together. Let us offer our lives together to Christ, as he has already given us freedom and loved us eternally.
Lord, I offer my life to you, everything. use it for your glory. Lord, I offer my days to you, lifting my praise to you as a pleasing sacrifice. Lord, I offer you my life, all that I am, all that I have. All that I am, all that I have, I lay them down before you, O Lord. All my regrets, all my acclaim, the joy and the pain, I'm making them yours. Things in the past, things yet unseen. Lord, I offer you my life to you. And let's arise, church. Lord, I offer my life to you. Everything I've been through, use it for your glory. Lord, I offer my days to you, lifting my praise to you as a pleasing sacrifice. Bow our heads, church, and pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this day. We are given another chance, Lord, to give out our best and this little portion that we have, Lord. We pray that you bless each heart and each hand that has given, Lord, and each offering that has been given can be used for your glory only, Lord, to expand your kingdom and to expand your works through our church. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. We also thank you for the word of God that has been given to us. And may each of us be touched by your word. And may we always be able to be shaped every day more and more to be like you through your love and your grace. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. And today we also want to pray for a few points of prayer, Lord. We want to pray firstly for the spiritual growth of each and every one of the members in this church, Lord, from the youngest to the most senior. May they be always be able to seriously pursue and seek you, Lord, to pursue each calling, Lord, that you have given to them. And may they be able to continuously serve the church of God, Lord, as your servants and as your children in this church. Lord, we also want to pray for the theological schools in Indonesia, wherever they may be, and may you bless and enable each lecturer there, each manager there, so they can be able to build the characters and build the theological basis properly for each and every one of the students there, so that when the time comes, they can produce servants of the Lord, not only in quantity, but in quality of character and teaching.
Lord, we want to pray for these future pastors, reverends, your servants, Lord, that are being guided right now, being shaped in these schools. May you be able to develop their calling, to make them confident in the calling that you've given them, Lord. Thank you. And always enable them to be able to go through every process of their shaping in their calling. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. These are our prayer points on this very morning. And in Jesus Christ's name, we lift them up all on you. Everybody say, amen. May be seated, church.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Reform Exodus Community. This is our church. This is our home. We would like to extend our warmest welcome to you, especially if this is your first time joining us. If you'd like to get connected with us, or you need someone to pray for you, please don't hesitate to call these numbers. Here are some of our brothers and sisters who are having their birthdays this week. Wishing all of you guys happy birthday. May the love, faith, and hope of Christ continue to strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit. Come and join our online morning prayer every Saturday at 5:30 a.m. Use the link here to get the Zoom link and other information. Come and join our discipleship group. We have one in each our local church. Please take a note of the day and time. Let's keep supporting one another and growing together during this hard time. That's all for our weekly announcement. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for He who promised is faithful. God bless you and see you next week.
Here at iREC Darmo. And also, if you are here for the first time, welcome. I'm so glad that you can, I hope that you enjoy worship this morning. And if you see someone new, please don't hesitate to, you know, call them up, say hi, greet, and you know, and especially, and this is true here, if you are new, this is the first time for you guys, your first cup of coffee is on us, okay? I'm expecting like clapping of hands, but okay, never mind. So if you are new, first coffee is free. A first cup of coffee is free. Second cup of coffee also free, free to pay. But the third cup of coffee, maybe you're also free, free to make on your own and become a barista. Okay. By the way, we're opening opportunities to be a barista if you are interested. Okay. So just want to add to that because that's important. All right. Welcome. So glad that you are here with us this morning. Just gonna a quick reminders. First of all, we apologize for the minor road work, you know, which I'm sure you all notice, especially if you use the front entrance. Suddenly you walk in and then you have this access and you can't walk here. It's almost like, you know, there's a trap for you. Know it's just we had some reparation, and you know, it would just be this Sunday, so next Sunday there won't be any mark on the floor anymore. But yeah, so we just completed some repairing for our toilet in the Ruko area, so that's in case you're wondering. So we had some repair being done, and also we plan to have another minor renovation for Sunday school downstairs. If you notice, we have a big Sunday school area right now, right? So if you are new, just wanna give you follow up with some information. So we used to have a Sunday school room in the second floor on that. If you go to that door, small door over there, it will lead to Sunday school, but that's an old room. Now it becomes a baby room, so you can use that to for your needs. Now we move the Sunday school to downstairs in the big first floor, and we plan to maybe put some partition so that some of the kids can really in a new space, you know, with a partition, and it will help everyone to minimize the sound, because I realized, you know, especially now when we have during a sermon, some of us, I believe, can still hear the kids, right, from downstairs. And I've gotten used to it, I guess, but maybe to minimize the distraction, that's what we plan to do, to kind of, you know, get a partition going on, and then so that the kids can also have a isolated, kind of an enclosed space for that. So I hope for your support, for your prayer again for that as well. And finally, in 2 weeks, we will have an Ascension Day service. Ibadah Kenaikan, okay? Ascension Day service. It's a holiday on Thursday, May 26th, okay? We will have a combined service with the Indonesian service. So I hope that you can participate and join us to enjoy and to reflect on the meaning of the Ascension. I will follow up with information about that worship service, but we will gather here at the same time as iREC, the English service, at 10 a.m., okay? So in two weeks, May 26th, Thursday, 10 a.m., Ascension Day combined service. I think that's all for me. Let's all stand as we close with the doxology this morning. Before you go, receive the benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of God the Holy Spirit be with us all from now on until forever and forevermore. Amen. Amen. You may be seated, church. You may have some quiet time before you go. God bless you all. Happy Sunday, and I'll see you next time.